Libby? Okay, go ahead and have a seat. And who was next? I forgot. Olive. Okay, so we got our stuff here.
Where do I need to
put them? Just set it down to the side someplace.
Over here.
All right, thanks.
Since your Pa Robert first left and told me to stay and protect our home. What with all those bummers coming through you, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. It just, nobody told me that Sherman would be waging this war right here in my kitchen. The Yankees, they got across the Chattahoochee River at Roswell 2 weeks ago. And the Southern Confederacy reported that they was just gonna keep the mills running. Your uncle, who was there, he said that they just rounded up everybody, women and children mostly, treated them all like prisoners of war. Women and children. I've had to open my own bank account, and the paper, said that starting in June of 64, which was last month, that your pa's pay would go from $18, $11 a month to $18. I've tried to keep us afloat by renting out Toby and Sam. They do each bring in $10 a month, but with rising prices, it's not always enough. And I've only kept the girl, Hattie. I can't believe that we ladies, we have to pay $7 for a single yard of calico fabric. It used to only be $3. Even flour has risen from $2 a barrel to almost $100. With all these rising prices, women started to riot last spring. But here in Atlanta, they didn't steal like they did in other places. They just paid what they thought was fit. Riots happened all over the South, everywhere from Macon to Richmond. Soon all that's left of the money and the valuables that we have stashed away before this horror will be gone. What with the raiders eating or taking anything of value, I fear that we'll starve. Church has been turned into a hospital. I've tried to do my part by volunteering every Sunday. Of course, I still read the good book and pray every night for your pa's safe return. There was one Yankee boy. I don't think I'd ever be able to forget him. He insisted that he must see a Catholic priest. So I hunted one down. He made me wait hours at the parish, and when he finally got there, he said, "I have to eat and take my nap first." I told him, "You can eat your fill and then we best be on our way," because I left him in the boy in that capable hands of the priest that night. And when I returned the next morning, his bed was empty. I cried for him that day. You know that the rail line connecting Atlanta to Augusta was cut yesterday. They've already cut the one to Montgomery. If that isn't bad enough, now they're taking the cut pieces of railway, heating them up, and twisting them around trees to make what they're calling Sherman's neckties. What if they do the same heading down to Macon? This is making it harder and harder to get letters from Robert. What with the blockades, it's nearly impossible to get specialty foods like coffee and sugar. How I miss my coffee. Never in a million years did I think that I'd be running a farm and working with money. But soon there won't be much farm left to manage without any field hands and the Yankee Army taking every horse and mule in this damn county. And to enlist in their services, of course. Of course, it only makes sense to exchange my nicer dresses for homespun. They're much more practical nowadays. When I was working at the hospital, it let me hear things that I know I wouldn't have heard otherwise. Like, I learned from both Federalists and you, and our men, that the papers, they don't print the whole truth. They sugarcoat it because they don't want us ladies to know the whole truth of the war. Shh. A black cabinet's already pay all people in horses. Remember when we had to go barter some corn for a new pair of shoes for your brother John? The depot was crawling with Union soldiers, almost like fleas on a dog. I promised myself that I wouldn't let some Yankee scare me, so I sat down and I pulled my knitting out. One man by the name of Corporal Daniels saw me. He said, if I were you, I'd put those away as they seem just a tad big for this here boy. It occurred to me that if a woman couldn't knit a good pair of socks for her husband, then the world must be coming to an end. I told him so. As I said this, I could see the start of a smile creeping onto his face. It was the first time I feel as though I've ever been treated as a human being by these men. I certainly will not call them gentlemen. They say they're here to free our slaves, but what they don't understand is that they're just stealing our property and our dignity, our livelihood. And they wonder why we're fighting this war. All I've ever done for my slaves is treat them almost like family. But then Hattie left, running away in the middle of the night, leaving me with a farm and you two little rascals. I've known Hattie my whole life. I've been awake for the past week wondering why she'd leave. Because I know that Robert is a much better master than the whole of Sherman's army. I just don't understand why she'd leave. And while I was forced into taking my independence, Hattie, she chose to take hers. And it seems like I've had to explore the strangest ideas lately. And while Robert chose to fight for our state, I didn't have a choice but to fight for our home. What General Sherman doesn't understand is that he's fighting us women and mothers and daughters as well. You know that I won't give up that easy. Because after all, the best protection any woman can have is courage.
Where to start? Tell us how you got started on this. You're a docent at Atlanta History Center?
I volunteer at the Atlanta History Center as a junior interpreter on their Smith Family Farm. And it really got me into, I already loved history, and it got me thinking more about the Civil War and the women and the civilians that were left behind and what they were feeling through the Civil War.
What was the main thing you wanted to take away from your presentation?
The main thing I wanted you to take away from my presentation was the viewpoint that the Southern women held was that they felt like they were in the right to own slaves because it was something that was given to them by their fathers and their grandfathers. Something else I'd like you to take away was that it felt like to them that Sherman was bringing the war home because Sherman understood that if he broke the women of the South, he would break the men as well.
I was looking through your sources, and there's lots of them. What one or two did you feel like this was that special one that just, oh, I can't believe I found this? And why?
One of them was Mary Ann Gay's Life in Dixie, because I'm from Decatur, and she lived in Decatur, and she was just at the right age of the character that I'm portraying. So I used her stories as, like the story about the boy and the priest. I got that from her, and I also got the Corporal Daniels story from her, because she was Margaret Mitchell's inspiration for Scarlet Oak, Gone with the Wind, and I figured if it's good enough for Margaret Mitchell, then it's good enough for me.
And I'm gonna assume that maybe you're gonna tie back to the diary that you had mentioned, but was there any connection that you felt during your research from everything that you looked at to yourself?
I'm not sure I quite understand the question.
Um, let me see if I can rephrase it.
Are you asking did you feel, in reading through and finding out about these people, that you felt like you had a connection to them?
Yeah.
I think I really did because at the History Center, I play a 13-year-old girl, not a 35-year-old woman. And so I've done my research on the adolescent women and how they were feeling at the time. But then when I started to do research on what the adults were thinking, the older generations, it stretched my mind a little bit more than, you know, just the young girls were like, oh, there's soldiers everywhere.
Did you find, and I'm asking here, did you find in your research, with the women that were left at home, did they all have this, it's the enemy? Or, because when I was listening to your story about finding the chaplain for the Union soldier, or was there stories of where the women saw humanity in both sides of compassion?
More of the stories when they saw compassion was the loyal Southerners, the regiments, the Union regiments from Alabama and Georgia and South Carolina, because they knew the men from the South, they knew what the women were going through, because they may not think slavery was the best, but they understood how the women were treated in the South and how they were very protected, very, very sheltered. And they understood that they saw the slaves almost childlike, and so that the mistresses were almost like a mother. And so they treated them more like they'd been used to being treated, opposed to when Northern regiments came down, the Southern regiments still enforced the laws, but they did it more gentlemanly.
How useful did you find your scholarly secondary sources? You know, Catherine Clinton, Drew Wildenfels, Betsy Fox Genovese. These are all big names in history, by the way.
I found them very, very helpful. Faust's Mother of Invention, that was one of my favorite sources to read, because her writing was very, very interesting, and her point of view was also pretty interesting.
Is there anything that we should have asked that we didn't ask that you'd like to tell us about?
Well, the character that I portrayed, she is an actual person. She is Adeline Smith Medlock. She is the fifth daughter out of six kids in the Smith family.
Of Roswell?
No, they actually lived in Decatur, right near where 85 and North Drury Hills cross.
Thank you.
Thank you.